Segment two, Karl Marx and Ronald Reagan. The Thomas Sowell Reader is, of course, a book of analysis and opinion. Not long ago, I asked you, Tom, what opinion, what view do you regret having held? And you replied that for more than a decade, you had been a serious Marxist.
Yes.
Explain that.
Well, as that decade began, I was living in poverty.
How old?
19 years old.
19. So you're in you're starting college at that stage?
Oh, or? Good heavens, no.
No, all right.
I mean, I was out there working in unskilled jobs and trying to make ends meet, living in a rooming house.
Up in Harlem? You're living in Harlem?
In Harlem.
Right.
I'd heard about Marx, but I finally someplace found an old secondhand set of encyclopedias for $1.19, which I bought. And there was an article on Karl Marx, and it seemed to me that he explained these situations so well that...
And the situation was what? That you took the train from Harlem down to the lower end of Manhattan?
The other way around, coming home from work, I would sometimes take the bus, and it would go right up Fifth Avenue past all these glitzy places, and cross 57th Street where all the fancy stores were, and Carnegie Hall and the rest of it. And then finally, as I got near home, it would kind of turn off this viaduct into 135th Street, and there was that sudden change in the whole scene at that point. And the question was, why was that? And the problem was two problems. One was that no one else had given any explanation. There was no competing explanation that sounded plausible.
In your life so far?
Yes.
Right.
Yes. And the other was that no one had cautioned me that it takes an awful lot more knowledge before you can make these kinds of sweeping judgments in any case. But fortunately, I'd been taught earlier to respect facts and so on. And so even during my years as a Marxist, I would read things by people who weren't Marxist. I would read facts and so forth.
But you I have heard you say many times that you got a good education in the New York City public schools.
Yes.
In Harlem.
Yes.
So they taught you to think. They
Yes.
may not have taught you Adam Smith and
Yes.
the defense of free markets, but they taught you to think.
Yes.
All right. Now, but continue the story, if you would. You're a Marxist at the age of 19, taking the bus home.
Right.
From the southern third of Manhattan Island
Right.
all the way up to Harlem. You remain a Marxist at the University of Chicago under the instruction of?
Milton Friedman.
Milton Friedman.
Yes.
How did that, if Milton couldn't crack you, you were a tough nut.
Well, but one summer working for the government as an economist was enough to show me that the government was really not the answer. That the level of understanding among the people, and I was in a program for interns where we saw the top officials of the Labor Department and so forth, and I realized these guys are not going to save us.
In other words, they were not the priestly caste
No.
that you might have been led to expect. They were ordinary chumps bashing their way through life as best they could like anybody else.
Yes.
I see. All right. And so, but intellectually, all right, you spend a summer working for the federal government, and that cures you of Marxism.
Yes.
But intellectually, when do you pick up the thread of free markets?
Oh, I guess, well, I had always...
You thought back to what Milton had said.
That's right.
It's not
just Milton, but Hayek and the rest of them.
Okay.
Because I had read all those people while I was still a Marxist.
A couple of... you have an essay in here entitled Marx the Man.
Oh, yes.
Quote, Marx's angry apocalyptic visions existed before he discovered capitalism as the focus of such visions.
Yes.
Explain that.
Well, the poems he wrote in his teen years, one of them in particular, I remember, went to this effect that, then will I walk godlike and triumphant through the ruins of the world. So he has these... apocalyptic visions early on, before he's ever even thought about capitalism.
And what the subtext, as I take it, of your, it's entitled Marx, not the Marx the political philosopher, not Marx the economist, but Marx the man.
Yes.
And what I felt reading that essay is, you're in effect, it's like the scene in The Wizard of Oz where they pull back the curtain.
Yes, that's right.
The great and powerful Oz turns out to be an ordinary, cranky human being.
Yes.
And what you're saying is Marx is fascinating in some, highly intelligent, and in some cases, in some ways, kind of a nut.
Yes.
Just a man.
Yes.
All right. Another quotation from that essay. The members of the Communist League, we're talking now about the mid-19th century, Marx and Engels form, or they participate in the Communist League. The members of the Communist League were overwhelmingly intellectuals and professionals. It had the same kind of social composition that would in later years characterize many radical groups in which the youthful offspring of privilege called themselves the proletariat. Marxism is the conceit of rich kids with fancy educations.
Yes, you see that in the, what is this thing called, the Occupy Wall Street group. All these middle class accents and so on. I mean, how many working class people can afford to take a month off to sit around in parks and carry on and have all their electronic equipment with them and all the rest of it? I mean, come
on. Sleeping in sleeping bags with the first rate down feathers.
Oh, yes.
Right. So, but at what stage was there a moment when you said, wait a moment, these putative Marxists and leftists and liberals, to use the term the way it's used in this country, as a leftist, they have no knowledge of nor concern for what life is like up on 130th Street.
That's right.
Was there a moment or an incident when that just struck you? Or was that kind of a progressive realization?
It was sort of a progressive realization.
All right. Ronald Reagan, the Thomas Sowell. I like juxtapositions here from Karl Marx to Ronald Reagan, but you do it yourself. One old-fashioned way to judge a president is by results. A more popular way is by how well he fits the preconception of the intelligentsia or the media. By the first test, Ronald Reagan was the most successful president of the United States in the 20th century. By the second test, he was a complete failure.
Yes.
The Marxists are rich kids with fancy educations. You've got the intelligentsia misreading Ronald Reagan. And you've got Tom Sowell from a very early age to the present, when he remains a fellow at Stanford, at the Hoover Institution at Stanford, making his career in academia all the same. How is it that you're able to swim against the current?
I don't know.
Please don't be quite so truthful. This is television. We need.
Oh, I guess partly luck. I don't know. It's there are places, and there are like the Hoover Institutions. No, it's no great handicap to have the views that I have here, and there are a few other places here and there.
Do you feel, as I mentioned to you before we started shooting, we put up a notice on our Facebook page, Uncommon Knowledge's Facebook page, saying that you'd be a guest, inviting people to submit questions, hundreds of questions. You are unambiguously the most requested guest on our little program. And if you read some of these comments, it's clear they come overwhelmingly from young people, many, many Wow. from college students. Do you feel a sea change?
Well, I think there have always been people who have been sort of the outposts, you know, sort of I think of Beaugest. But no, there have always been some people like that. And I'm glad they watch your program.
All right.